arguably one of the most recognisable names and faces when it comes to the aftermarket diesel tuning world is Gale Banks from Banks Power. In particular, we're big fans of Gale's YouTube channel. We love his analytical approach to analysing certain aspects of diesel engine performance and the way he develops his products. Well, the power is one side of the coin, particularly here in the US where the EPA are really cracking down on emissions in particular, but making sure that you're making good power with reliability, but also remaining emissions compliant is quite important. And of course, on the diesel engines, modern diesel engines, we've got diesel particulate filters, you've got diesel exhaust fluid injection into the exhaust system for catalyst effect. How much can we do while retaining that equipment? I know a lot of people want to take all of that away and throw it away, but if
that's
you want to...
over. Those days are gone. You know, full deletes are so illegal. And now the EPA is on the purveyors, the guys who provided the electronic aspect of that. We've never done that aspect because we have our own ECU. If we want to build an emissions-free engine, then for racing, we do it. But the average truck driven on the street, and this depends on the level of enforcement in whatever state you live in, it used to be very, and still is, very tight in California. But now, I think 14 or 15 other states have adopted California, but the big dog EPA is all over this, and they're taking out the people who have done this because it's criminal. So, At the end of the day, we look at, like the DPF, much of the aftermarket tuning provides additional fuel, some of which does not get consumed in cylinder. So if you do a smoky diesel tune, you're putting smoke in the air rather than using that fuel energy in cylinder. We don't go there. We have an AVL device that measures the micro soot going into the DPF. We also can look at soot loading in the DPF. So when we do a tune, we accept the fact that there's back pressure because of the oxycat. Mm-hmm. You know, there's two catalytic devices and a DPF. So it adds up to 4 or 5 pounds of back pressure. Also on the Fords and the GMs, from the DPF out, they're blending cool air with hot air. So you don't put out extremely high temp, 1100 degree exhaust out of the tailpipe tip during regen.
So there's a lot going on there. And I think one of the aspects is before these diesel particulate filters were commonplace, we did see a lot of smoky tunes and rolling coal was pretty commonplace. A lot of people want that. However, we do see that, you know, in simple terms, very, very simple terms, adding additional fuel into a diesel engine to a degree is going to increase the power. But the problem with the DPF is if you aren't really aware of what's going on, you can be creating a smoky tune pre-DPF and then essentially you're making more power but just filling up the DPF.
That's why we use the micro soot analyzer.
So that micro soot analyzer, you're looking at the soot output straight out of the engine, basically pre-DPF, exactly. So you know how much extra load you're placing on the DPF.
Yeah, and you don't want to regen it constantly. The back pressure across the DPF is a function of the soot load. So we don't want to have it regenning all the time. We don't want its average back pressure to be higher than stock. So we really watch the regen cycle rate on a stock truck is our bogey. We don't want additional regens.
Now, I probably should go back there because a lot of our viewers may not actually even know what a regen cycle is. So essentially that DPF collects the particulate matter in the exhaust and it will fill up over time. So the regen cycle is used to essentially superheat the DPF and burn off that soot, basically freshening it, ready to collect more. Is that a simplistic enough way of looking at it?
Yeah, but you burn fuel to create that heat.
So that also reduces your fuel economy. So
absolutely.
It's not a win-win situation.
No. So we tune our inline devices to honor a specific air-fuel ratio and a specific soot output.
So essentially you've got it as good as it can possibly be with the DPF in place.
So we're diminishing the pumping losses as the piston rises on the exhaust stroke by reducing back pressure. We don't get rid of all of it, but we get rid of a significant percentage. So we combine better air density in, less restriction out, and that allows us to tune more aggressively and makes the engine a hell of a lot more efficient.
Now, another thing I want to touch on there, you're sort of just getting towards that anyway, is the diesel engine tuning. I've sort of mentioned before, in broad terms, we can add fuel, we're going to end up making more power. Mm-hmm. We're adding fuel, ending up with a richer air-fuel ratio. Of course, the aspect of that is we do end up creating a lot more heat, and this is where we need to manage that heat with a diesel engine tuning in order to remain reliable. The problem with a lot of the diesel trucks, particularly here in the US, is they are used for towing very heavy loads. And we can get to a situation where you can create a tune that's perfectly safe and very powerful on an unladen truck, but then go and put a very heavy load on it, tow it up a hill, and it's a very different situation. How are you managing that when you're deciding on where the safe area is for your tunes? Is it through monitoring and controlling EGT directly, or do you have a benchmark?
First of all, we're keenly aware of constant duty. Our military engines have to pass a 400-hour NATO test, 85% of which is at full torque or full horsepower. 2 hours full torque, 2 hours full horse. That's everything the engine will do. You'll never see that in a pickup truck. So we engineer all of our tuning to do exactly what you just talked about at any altitude with any air inlet density you come up with. If you're a cowboy and you do the old smokey tune and try to push it through a DPF, you'll soon plug up that DPF. But secondly, the heat. You mentioned heat a minute ago. We're looking at EGT, of course. But we're looking at air-fuel ratio, and air-fuel ratio is the prime thing here. If the OE is at 18-1 air-fuel, that's our bogey. So how do we get more air into the engine? How do we get that compressor to produce more air density so we can mix that air mass with fuel mass? Same EGT if you're at the same air-fuel ratio. It's pretty... They relate to each other.
So essentially, while you're adding more fuel, you're also adding more air. So you're getting a larger combustion charge inside the engine, but maintaining essentially an OE air-fuel ratio target.
That's it. Yeah, exactly. My goal is with intake, exhaust, and tuning to 70 to 100 more horsepower and torque 120, 140 pound-feet. And stay within the design of all the major components on the engine and in the exhaust system. I'm a racer. Holding back like that is tough to do. I get the idea of why guys want a full delete, because now you can just blow smoke. I've never, ever had a diesel record holding vehicle that smoked, and we've held quite a few. So that being the case, including Bonneville, where we ran that first common rail Cummins, no smoke, 222 miles an hour.
I think it's reasonable to say that with the continued drive towards improved or reduced emissions, we're going to see less and less smoke and more sort of people focusing on making sure that the tune will work with all of those emissions components intact. Look, Gale, it's been great to get some insight into that. I think it's fair to say we live in a pretty exciting time with the current crop of diesel engines, the amount of performance that we are able to get out of them. So hopefully you guys will continue producing great products. So thanks for the chat there.
Thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.